وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةً وَبُشْرَى لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ. And we have sent down the book, yani the Quran, sent it down on thee, O Muhammad, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, in order that this Quran might explain all things. And therefore, it might explain the changing world, might explain the mysterious world in which we live today. Tibyanan likulli shay'in. And in this Quran there is guidance. And in this Quran there is that which has come as rahmah from Allah, an act of kindness and mercy on His servants. And for those servants of Allah to do what they should do, to turn to the Quran and to study it properly and to seek diligently for that explanation and that guidance and then follow it. Bushra lahum, good news and glad tidings for such believers. For they will see what others cannot see, and they will succeed what others will not succeed. Which surah of the Quran was it? Surah 2? Can you help me? Surah 2. This is a small gathering, so I can take my time today. Oh yes, I can do that. Surah 2? That's not a good start, eh? You're going to get more questions, then. Surah al-Nahl, the Quran, Surah number 16, entitled The Bee. The Bee. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, who was sent to teach the Quran, spoke to us about an age of awesome fitna, tests and trials. And he used the plural, the word fitan, age of fitan. And in Suratul number 8, Suratul number 8, Al-Fatiha, Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, and then Al-Nisa, and then Al-Ma'idah, and then Al-An'am, and then Al-A'raf, and then MashaAllah. Al-Anfal. In Surah 2, Anfal, you like my style as a teacher? In Surah 2, Anfal of the Quran, Surah number 8, Al-Anfal, the spoils of war, the booty of war. Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُسِبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً وَعَلَّمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعَذَابِ. And fear that kind of fitna which is to come, which when it comes will target not only those who are wicked, but all of mankind will be targeted. All of mankind will be tested. Be conscious of the fact that Allah is terrible in His punishment. He who is a kind and merciful and loving and compassionate and forgiving God, also says that he is terrible in his punishment. This was Suratul. And Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam gave us signs by which we can recognize that age of terrible fitna, or tests and trials. For the one that is the most visible, you have to be blind not to see it, is that a time will come when you will find the naked, barefooted shepherds competing with each other in the construction of tall buildings. In other words, a time is going to come when mankind will measure progress on the basis of the heights of buildings. And if you don't have any high-rise buildings, you will be considered to be backward. But most people would be proud of the Twin Towers because this is a symbol of progress. And the Prophet is saying of such people who measure progress this way, that they have the intellectual acumen and the moral status of naked, barefooted shepherds, which is fairly soft language. Are we in that age now?
Yes.
When Manhattan has embraced the whole world? Yes, we are. And so now, more than ever before, we need to turn to the Quran, so that the Quran might explain the reality of the world today. I'm going to take my time. And any time you feel you have enough, you can get up and leave. But I'm going to take my time, because I have a small audience here tonight, today. What is the methodology that we need to study the Quran? This is an introduction to Usul al-Tafsir. Usul al-Tafsir is methodology for the study of the Quran, to explain the Quran. At the beginning of the Quran, you may have noticed that there is the narrative in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave an order to the angels, and he asked them to make sijda to Adam alayhi salam. Fasajadu illa Iblis. And so they are all prostrated except Iblis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not deficient in the use of language. No. And so this sentence is constructed by divine wisdom in this specific way. If we use the wrong methodology and we study this event in isolation by itself, or the Americans say, stand alone. You study the verse, stand alone, the wrong methodology. Then you cannot escape the conclusion that Iblis was an angel. Double A, can't escape. He has to be an angel. Why? Because the order was very clearly given to the angels, and they all bow down except Iblis. So Iblis has to be an angel. Can't get away from that. Christian theology came to the same conclusion. And then they had to resort to scriptural gymnastics to conclude that Satan was something that they call a fallen angel. Angels, you know, fall down sometimes. So fallen angel. But he was an angel. Lucifer was an angel. Allah is doing this to us to teach a lesson in methodology. So we broadcast to the world that Iblis was an angel. And having broadcast it to the world that Iblis is an angel, using that wrong methodology, we then proceeded to study the rest of the Quran. But as we proceeded to study the rest of the Quran, oh my, we're in trouble. Because the Quran teaches that angels do not have a free will. Angels do not have the capacity for choice. No. Allah says about the angels, وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. Whatever they are ordered to do, they do it. They have no choice. But this fellow clearly exercised choice. This fellow appears to have free will because he disobeyed. Angels cannot disobey. Oh my, we're becoming embarrassed now because remember we announced Iblis has to be an angel. And now the evidence is clear. He could not have been an angel. You used the wrong methodology. And that was not all. When Allah asked him, why did you not prostrate when I ordered you to prostrate? The response that we got was from someone who had the capacity to think, who had the capacity to reason, who had what we may call a creative intellect. This fellow was a logician because he said, I am superior to him. You created me from fire and you created him from clay. And they taught me at the University of Singapore that fire is superior to clay. It follows logically therefrom that I am superior to him. That's the answer. أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْهُ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ تِينٍ. Oh, but wait a minute. Angels do not have the capacity to acquire knowledge independently. No. Angels have no knowledge other than that which Allah gives to them. The angel said, La ilma lana illa ma 'allamtana. We have no knowledge other than that which you give to us. But he is debating with Allah. He is displaying a mind capable of thinking. He could not have been an angel. So now we're becoming progressively more embarrassed because we announced that Iblis is an angel using the wrong methodology. And then finally, to put the lid on it all, in Suratul Kahf of the Quran, Allah says, وَكَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِ. Iblis. It's a jinn. Here we have the first lesson in methodology, and it is so simple. Allah has taught the lesson so simply. The first lesson in methodology is do not study any verse of the Quran or any hadith of the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam in isolation. Do not make the mistake of saying, God and Maqad cannot be released until Jesus has come back. And only when he has come back and he has killed the Dajjal, only then will Allah release God and Maqad into the world. Because Ali says so. Already? Did you look at the rest of the material? You're going to have your face looking red, you know, when you come to such definitive conclusion on the study of one hadith, and you even misunderstanding the solitary hadith. Guess where we are today? We are today in a state in which the overwhelming majority of the scholars of Islam all around the world, not just the Arab world, all around the world, turn to one solitary hadith, one, and misunderstand that one, and come to the unshakable conclusion that Ya'juj and Ma'juj, God and Magad, are not the same thing released into the world, because of the use of wrong methodology. This is the state of the world of Islam today. And so the subject that we are teaching is important. Well then, how should we study the Quran? Answer. First, remember that at the beginning of Surah Ali Imran, I think it is verse number 7, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about two kinds of verses in the Quran. He says there are those which are muhkam, plain and clear, not subject to ta'wil interpretation, plain and clear. For example, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. Which month is it that you must fast? Shahr Ramadan. There are no two ways about that. That is plain. But Allah says that there are also a second kind of verse in the Quran. And these are called the mutashabihat. And the essential characteristic of this second kind of verses is that they are subject to ta'wil. They must be interpreted. And it is in respect of this second kind of verse in the Quran that you must ensure that you first study all the verses in the Quran pertaining to that particular subject. If I may be allowed to use the word data. Collect all the data in the Quran on this subject. Every scientist knows this. No scientist worth his name could use a different methodology. No. Study all the data in the Quran. Collect all the data in the Quran on this subject. And then because the Quran says of itself, لَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ, had this Quran come from any source other than from Allah, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا, they would have found in it many contradictions, internal and external. But because it has come from Allah, there are no contradictions in the Quran, not internal or external. as a consequence, we now know that after we have collected all the data in the Quran, for example, the one in which we are most interested, all the data pertaining to the age of fitan, or the Malay know it better as akhiru zaman, collect all the data. And because we know that there are no contradictions in the Quran, it follows that all of this data must be harmoniously integrated to combine together to form a single harmonious whole. In other words, each verse of the Quran will become like a pearl. And having collected all the pearls, we now have the task, which every scientist knows about, of stringing all the pearls together to make a necklace. A necklace. The scientist knows that in order for him to do that, he has to find out what it is which is common, which binds them all together. My teacher of blessed memory, Mawlana Dr. Fadlur Rahman Ansari Rahimahullah, in his book, The Quranic Foundations and Structure of Muslim Society, he calls this necklace the system of meaning. The system of meaning. So when you have located the system of meaning, then you can go to that one verse to see, to locate its meaning. But Allah in His wisdom, and in His kindness, blocks you. This is not like a scientific study, not the verses of the Quran. He says in Surah Al-Isra, وَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ, when you recite the Quran, جَعَلْنَا بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ, we place between you and those who do not have faith in the Akhirah, حِجَابًا مَسْتُورًا, we place a hijab, a barrier, curtain, which is mastur, which is covered. So they will never be able to discover the string that binds the pearls together to make a necklace. They will never be able to discover the system of meaning. All the think tanks in Israel, all the think tanks in New Delhi, all the think tanks in Washington cannot double it, because Allah blocks them. But if you have faith in your heart in Allah, then Allah can put nur in your heart. This nur is not sold in the stock market. Allah knows who are those who worship Him, and who are those who worship the U.S. visa. Yes. He knows who are those who worship Him, and who are those who worship their job instead. Oh, I can't say that. If I were to say that, I'd lose my job. I won't get promotion. Huh? My business will collapse. I won't be able to travel. I got to protect my business. Oh, I see. Well then, I want to tell you something. You actually worship your business, you're not worshiping Allah. Well, yes, you're worshiping your job, you're not worshiping Allah. You're worshiping your green card, not Allah. But when the heart is in the right place, and the heart worships Allah, and you are loyal to Allah, and there is no other loyalty to rival your loyalty to Allah, then you can have faith in the Akhirah. And only then, would you get the noor with which to be able, that every scientist must have, but insight, scientific insight, to be able to penetrate the system of meaning which binds the subject together. When we have done that, then and only then do we now expand our database to go to the Ahadith. You must first go to the Quran and study the Quran before going to the Hadith. When you go to the Ahadith, Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam was sent to teach the Quran. So, you will now include in your database all the Ahadith which are in harmony with the system of meaning that you have located in your study of the data. And so your database now expands to include not only the verses of the Quran, but also all the ahadith which are in harmony. What do you do when you find a hadith which is in conflict? It can't fit in. It could not be strung onto this necklace. It is in conflict with what you have located in the Quran and the other ahadiths that you have joined in the Quran. Answer. When there is even the appearance of a conflict between what is in the Quran and what is in the hadith, answer, you must stay with the Quran. That is so simple. It is yet baffling. How come we can't understand it? The methodology for identifying and secluding those ahadiths which can be considered to be fabricated. Yeah. Because only the Quran is divinely protected. I don't think anybody would argue with that. And therefore only the Quran has a divine guarantee of absolute authenticity. I don't think anybody would argue with that. And not even the best hadith, not even the best hadith has such a status. For some 200 years after the death of the Prophet, Muslims never collected their hadith because of the prohibition. And only after 200 years have passed and the status of the Quran had been established, only then did you begin the process of collecting and compiling and assessing a hadith in order that the mistake should never be made, never, that a hadith can have the same status as the Quran. No. And in order, therefore, that Muslims would understand that it is the Quran which must sit in judgment over the hadith and not vice versa. We have now concluded, I believe, what is the best introduction to Usul al-Tafsir. And it was very simple, not complicated at all. So now you can go and teach the subject. Because it's clear, it's crystal clear. Nothing here that can be challenged. In Surah Al-Baqarah, the Quran, verse 106, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a startling statement. We had already completed 13 years in Mecca. We arrived in Medina. There's a large community of Jews in Medina. All the heavens are watching. Will they accept the last prophet? Or will they reject him? The whole heavens are watching. If they accept him, عَسَىٰ أَن يَرْحَمَكُمْ عَسَىٰ رَبُّكُمْ أَن يَرْحَمَكُمْ. It is possible that your Lord can have mercy in you. Badu Israel. This is indeed your last chance. This is the last door to mercy, the last prophet. If you reject him, then Allah is going to close the door to mercy to you. The Jews said of themselves that they're not going to be judged as individuals. No. That's for the rest of mankind. We are the chosen people of Allah. And so we are going to be judged as a community, not as an individual. And as a community, we'll all enter into heaven. So when Nabi Muhammad ﷺ arrived in Medina, this was the last chance for him. He did a number of things that made it as plain as daylight. He is indeed a prophet of God. For example, he did what no Arab could possibly do, get away with it. He turned his back to the Kaaba, and he turned towards Jerusalem to perform Salah. He did this when he arrived in Medina. The Jews were absolutely astonished. How could an Arab turn his back to the Kaaba when the Kaaba is the heart of the Arab world of religion? You can't be an Arab and do that. And he turns towards our Qibla. Huh? Here is evidence as dazzling as the sunshine. This man could not be other than a prophet of God. He did more than that. He fasted with the Jews on the days when they fasted, and in accordance with the law of fasting in the Torah. It's still there in the Torah. From sunset to sunset, no food, no drink, you could not go to your wives. No Arab ever fasted like that. And he is fasting with us. Not only is he praying to our Qibla, he's fasting with us in accordance with the law of fasting in our book. Here is evidence as dazzling as the sunshine. This man could not be other than a prophet. And then they attempted to test him. They brought two people who had confessed to adultery, zina. Oh Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you kindly judge this case for us. There was a trap. But it boomeranged on them, I think. Boomerang is an Australian word. Boomeranged on them. Because he asked, what punishment do you give? Oh my, they must have started to sweat cold. What punishment do you give? They said, well, we make their faces black and we beat them. He asked, is this the punishment in your book? Bring the Torah. Now they're sweating cold because the trap is boomeranging up there. So they had to bring the Torah. And they had to appoint someone to recite from the relevant passage because he, Muhammad alayhi salam, could not read. But Abdullah bin Salam was their rabbi. And Abdullah bin Salam had taken the Shahada become a Muslim. He's standing there. So when the fellow started to read from the Torah, and I'm looking forward one day, I hope inshallah, to see the video. He's reading from the Torah. And when he came to the verse on Rajab, he put his finger on it to read over it. So Abdullah bin Salam said, stop. Raise your finger. I want to see the video. Raise your finger. Now read. So he had to read that the Torah is saying that the punishment for zina is stoning to death. That is the punishment which is still there in book. The Jews must be stuttering now, stammering. Well. You see, when the big men committed zina, we have to pick them. Get them off. He's a big man. Here in Malaysia, the big men are called the Tonku and the Tun and Salam. When the small people committed zina, we could not stone them to death. And let off the wicked. So we decided to make a new law. So they were exposed. Prophet Muhammad Islam then applied the law which was in their book and ordered that the two people be stoned to death. They had never seen anybody being stoned to death for hundreds of years. Hundreds of years. And here is a man who is enforcing their law, which they were not enforcing. And when there were cases of zina amongst the Muslims, he then enforced the law amongst the Muslims. Here was evidence as dazzling as the sunshine. This man could not be other than a true prophet of God. But they still could not accept him as a prophet. Why? I have a book entitled The Religion of Abraham and the State of Israel, a view from the Quran. Some of you may have seen it. In that book I've explained why. If we accept Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, who is an Arab, who has come from Ismail alayhi salam, if we accept him as a prophet, the implication would be that our book is filled with lies. And we cannot accept that our book is filled with lies. So they rejected him. When they rejected him, and they were now conspiring to destroy Islam, it was then that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shut the door of the masjid. Tilka ummatun qad khalat. The door to mercy is now shut. An individual Jew will now have to make tawbah. Individual. But in the collective community, the God of mercy is shown. This ummah now belongs to history. A new ummah is born. And this ummah has superseded that previous ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then proceeded to give a demonstration of how He created the new ummah. He changed the law. Can you do that? Oh, He is a supreme lawmaker. He can change His law. He can replace it with another law. But there can be no contradiction then between an old law and a new law. No contradiction. So He changed the law of Qibla and replaced it with a new law of Qibla. The new Qibla is in Tel Hosni Mubarak, is not in Washington. The new Qibla is in Makkah and also Parvez Musharraf. The new Qibla is in Makkah. It is this phenomenon of the change of law that now takes place, that Allah is referring to in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 106. He says, مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِهَا نَأْتِي بِخَيْرٍ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. We do not cancel, we do not abrogate any ayah, but that we replace it with that which is better or similar, not contradictory, better or similar. So the old law is now mansukh. Mansukh is not an Arab restaurant in KLCC. Mansukh is that which is abrogated, cancelled. Mansukh. The first instance of nasakh is the change of Qibla. Good. Did Allah say that? Well, the new Qibla is valid for the whole year. But I give you one day of the year that you could still turn to the old Qibla. Huh? No. So the old one is cancelled completely. Not 50%. Or 70%. No. When he brings about nasakh, he cancels completely, totally, and he replaces it completely, totally. Are you with me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Alright. Now you'll see why I'm doing this. And you'll understand why I'm proceeding so slowly. I can take my time because I have a small audience today. He then proceeded to the second instance of nasakh, and that is he changed the law of fasting. Yes, he gave us the new law of fasting. Number one, we no longer fast from sunset to sunset.
Oh, there were lots of smiles in Medina when the new law came down.
Now we fast from dawn to sunset. And during the night, kulu washrabu,
you can
eat and you can drink, except that in Kuwait and Abu Dhabi, they spent the whole night eating and drinking.
They spent the whole night eating and drinking.
It is such a wonderful time. such a lovely, lovely, lovely time in Ramadan. I spent one Ramadan in Egypt, and I was invited. I was just 21 years of age. I have never before in my life experienced everybody sitting around one bowl and everybody eating from the same bowl. Never experienced it. I mean, I was born in the island of Trinidad in the Caribbean. So the Egyptian family invited me for breaking the fast. And then there was this big dish, and the food was on the dish. And I noticed you get separate plates. Maybe they're from other plates. No, Imran. This is a different way. And we all sat down around this big plate, and we all ate from the same plate. MashaAllah. What a lovely time it is in Ramadan. In the night time, when you break the fast. Thank Allah for that. But that was not all. There was another reason why we were smiling even more.
Allah says in the Quran, أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَى نِسَائِكُمْ.
It is halal for you on the nights of fasting to go to your wives. So we are smiling even more now. But then he said something else that stopped our smiles.
He said, عَلِمَ اللَّهُ أَنَّكُمْ كُنْتُمْ تَخْتَانُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Allah knows what you used to be doing secretly when you're supposed to be staying away from them. فَتَعَلَى عَلَيْكُمْ.
So Allah has now turned towards you mercifully. وَعَفَى عَلَيْكُمْ. And Allah has forgiven you.
So now we smile.
فَلَا نَبَاشِرُهُمْ. So now you're free to embrace them on the nights of fasting. And when you embrace them, وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. And now seek for what Allah has written for you. Meaning, Allah does the writing. Allah writes how many children you will have, how many boys and how many girls. He didn't write extra for Terengganu, you know. He writes how many children you will have. It's just that Terengganu was following Allah's law. So in Terengganu they have big families, 10 children, 12 children. When we attempt to take over from Allah and do the right thing ourselves, then we're going to have only 2 children, 1 boy, 1 girl. Anytime you attempt to take over from Allah and do the right thing, today is called planned parenthood. You commit an act of shirk. You commit an act of shirk. You can say, if your wife's life is going to be in danger, if there's a serious threat to her health, we are not fools, we are not dum-dums. This is an intelligent religion. Don't disrespect this religion. If a wife's life or health is going to be in danger, then this is an abnormal situation. And in such an abnormality, you can take steps to try to prevent conception. But to protect yourself, you can say, oh Allah, I'm doing this. But if you have ordained that the baby is to be born, nothing I can do will prevent it. So now, this is the second instance of nasr. When Allah changed the law, did He say that, well, you can fast now in Ramadan for a few years, but then after some time you can go back to the old law for 1 year? No. The old law was completely and totally and irrevocably cancelled, isn't it? totally, completely, irrevocably, and replaced permanently by a new law. Okay, why is Imran spending so much time on this? Because there is a third instance of nasr that we must now come to. Allah changed the law of punishment for adultery. Oh yes, He did. And when you go to the Quran to see Noor, you will find the new law that He sent down.
You know what was the old law. The old law is in the Torah. And this is the new law which is in the Quran.
And the new law is a public flogging. Oh, did He say, well, you can have the new law Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and the old law Saturday and Sunday? Did He say that? Is there only a partial cancellation of the old law? And a partial replacement by the new law? No, no, no. The old law is totally, completely, and irrevocably cancelled. Now you understand why I took my time. And it is replaced totally and completely by a new law. Well, then what do you do when you find a hadith,
even in Bukhari,
we say that, oh no, 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 no. The old law is not completely cancelled.
No.
The old law is cancelled only when they are not married. But if they are married, the old law is still in force.
Yes, there are several ahadiths.
What do you do when the ahadiths are in conflict with the Quran?
Now we know who are those who have backbone to adopt the proper methodology. And those who want to still continue to wander in the wilderness. This is how important this subject is. It is an explosion waiting to occur. This is an explosion waiting to occur.
The Egyptian armed forces which responded to the uprisings in Egypt in a suspiciously docile way are likely to present to Egypt free and fair elections. And free and fair elections would be intended to lead to a massive victory in the polls to the Islamic parties. And when the Islamic parties formed the government in Egypt, there would be a hue and a cry, let us enforce the Sharia. Why would Washington be so keen? And London be so keen, and Israel be so keen, that Egypt should enforce the Sharia. Huh? We thought that they were opposed to the Sharia. This is a time bomb waiting to explode.
Because the Islamic governments that will come to Egypt, and to Tunisia, and to Yemen, and to Syria, will now have to decide. What is the punishment for zina?
And there are lots of zina, I know. Lots of zina in the world today, you know that. And so the world is going to be treated to the spectacle. They will cause the heavens to shake with anger of Muslim governments stoning people to death. It has not happened so far. I don't know. I think in Nigeria they found some loophole. I don't know what Kalantan has done. Have they stolen anyone in Kalantan again?
Assalamualaikum, Chef. You did mention when Rasulullah SAW implemented the stoning for the Jew didn't implement it for 100 of years.
Okay. The tell me when you had enough, huh?
Never enough.
Never enough.
But there can be a second installment.
I know that you send a piece of paper, you know, if I This is an example of the kind of problem you have when you use wrong methodology. How old was Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha when Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam married her? Nine? Oh. Seven? What did the hadith say? The hadith, you don't speak, eh?
Six.
Okay. Hadith says six, eh?
Together at nine.
Can you imagine what's going to happen when an Islamic government comes to Egypt? When an Islamic government comes to Tunisia and Yemen and Syria? And the view and pride goes up and forces the Sharia. And then you can be sure that Israel, the Mossad is going to spend a lot of money to get people to come forward. My daughter is six. I want her to be married and I want a marriage certificate. Or CNN is going to send 100 correspondents. Al Jazeera will be there with the whole bandwagon to cover that. And the whole world will be witnessing the spectacle of Muslims marrying their daughters at six because Muhammad married Aisha at the age of six because the hadith says so. The hadith says so. So my response is that were there any witnesses to the marriage? If there are none, then any donku, any tun, any raja could not marry without a witness to that. Yeah, you could get married without a witness. Very convenient, isn't it? If he did not have witnesses. For a marriage to be valid, there must be witnesses. So where were the witnesses? Do we have any evidence of the witnesses? Okay, number two. In order for a marriage to be valid, the consent of the girl must be obtained. And if she has her wali, you have to ask the wali. And the wali must have the freedom to say yes or no on her behalf. If he does not have the freedom to say no, that is not a valid marriage. So the question that we are asking is, in this so-called marriage ceremony that you all just said that he had, did Aisha and her father, Abu Bakr Siddiq, did they have the option, the freedom to say yes or no? If they wanted to say no, they could have said no. Is that so? How come you're so quiet now? The answer is that there was never a marriage ceremony. Never. And whoever said that there was a marriage ceremony, you should be sent to Disneyland on a one-way ticket. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam never married Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. There was never, for him to marry her, you have to have a marriage ceremony. There was never a marriage ceremony. No. All that there was announcement that Allah had done it. And that news was conveyed to us down here. He did. He ordained the marriage. Neither did the Prophet have anything to do with it, nor did she have anything to do with it. He had no option, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, and she had no option, none. Allah ordained. He decided it. And so say that the Prophet married her at the age of 6 is false. To say that the Prophet married her at the age of 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 or 11 or 12 or 13 or 14 or 15 is false. To say that the Prophet married her is false. He never married her. Where is the evidence for a marriage to take place? You must have choice. There was no choice. Once Allah had announced, this is your wife, that's it. That's it. She had no choice in the matter. Allah could have given that announcement before she was born, that a child is going to be born and that child will be your wife. So would you say he married her before she was born? What kind of dumb thinking is this? Allah could have ordained that she be married to him when she was 1 day old. So then would you say that Muhammad married Aisha radiallahu ta'ala at the age of 1 day? Nonsense. What nonsense. He is Allah. He is fa'alul lima yurid. He can do whatever he wants to do. And it is his decision. And he decided it to test you. And how many have failed the test? How many have failed the test? So on judgment day, if you had said, if you had ever said that Muhammad alayhi salatu was married Aisha when she was 6 or 7 or 8, on judgment day Allah will ask you, Hatu Burhanakum, come bring the proof. Bring the proof. It's going to be a sorry spectacle. It's simply a matter of having the capacity to assess the authenticity of a hadith. That it is the function of the Quran to sit in judgment over the hadith. Only the Quran is absolutely authentic. And no hadith has that status. And so I've given you today on the subject of the punishment for zina, a time bomb that is waiting to explode. Maybe in the next few months, maybe by next year, it's going to bring shame and disgrace on the world of Islam. When all the ulama all around the world, starting with Al-Azhar University, because Kalantan will have no choice at that time, can't break anymore. That the punishment for zina is that time. If you are unmarried, then it's flogging. But if you are married, it is stoning to death. And we have to now enforce the law, because Egypt is doing it, and Tunisia is doing it. We are going to make a mess of ourselves. We are going to look really bad. Not too long from now. This is one of the potential implications of the mysterious Arab uprisings that I have not been able to speak about so far before today. The subject goes on even more embarrassing than what I've so far expressed to you. It's even more embarrassing. Remember in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah speaks about Nas, what words was it? 106, mashallah, you're not sleeping, good. 106 Surah Al-Baqarah. مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِهَا نَأْتِ بِخَيْرٍ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. We do not cause any ayah to be cancelled or abrogated, but that we replace it. No, sorry. We do not cause any ayah to be cancelled and abrogated or forgotten. But that we replace it with that which is similar or better. I was sitting down in the classroom of Tafsir at the Alimia Institute of Islamic Studies in Pakistan. I must have been about 23 years of age at that time. And in the classroom, sometimes we used to fall asleep in the classroom. But what happened that day caused me to wake up from my sleep. The teacher said that there used to be a verse of the Quran here, Surah An-Nur, and it's no longer in the Quran. So I said to myself under my breath, Hosein, Lord, what nonsense is this? When you're 23 years old, you could say that. What nonsense is this I'm hearing? That there used to be a verse of the Quran here. It's no longer there in the Quran. When the class was over, I didn't sleep for the rest of the class. When the class was over, I left. I went straight to the office of Maulana Dr. Fadl Rahman Ansari. And I said to him, Maulana, I just heard this in the classroom. Of course, you can't tell them, Mona, what nonsense is this? Mona, what is this? He then turned to me and said to me, son, they are wrong. No verse of the Quran has been cancelled, abrogated, or forgotten. He said, cancellation and abrogation apply to revelation which came before the Quran. And we gave you three examples so far. Three. And then my heart rested when I heard what he said. But then as a good student, I pursued the subject and I found that he was almost alone on the subject.
Excuse me.
Everybody deferred with him. You could hardly find any scholar of Islam who would say the same thing that he said. 99% of the ulama hold the view that there was internal nasakh in the Quran. That some verses cancel other verses. And that some verses were forgotten. And there were many different lists that were compiled. Some scholars giving us 49 instances of nasakh in the Quran. Another saying no, it's 35. Another saying no, it's 25. Another saying no, it's only 15. Until along came an Indian scholar of supreme scholarship, whose name was Shah Waliullah, who studied in Mecca and who was certainly a great scholar. And he said, they're all wrong. It's only five. They're all wrong, it's only five. And he wrote a classic book. الفوز الكبير في أصول التفسير. Textbook ready for study of أصول التفسير. And we studied that book as students. Not that I remember much about it. الفوز الكبير في أصول التفسير. And in that book he argues that there are only five instances of nasq in the Quran. But most scholars don't accept that. And much more than five. And then in Pakistan I met another great scholar who was a medical doctor who gave up his medical practice and devoted his entire life to the study of the Quran and preaching the Quran. Dr. Israr Ahmad Marhum, he passed away recently. Have mercy on his soul and grant him jannah. Ameen. And Dr. Israr Ahmad said to me that if I work on it, I can make it three. I can make it three. And here Dr. Ansari saying, none. None. The amazing thing is that Dr. Ansari is correct. If any verse of the Quran is cancelled, or abrogated, or forgotten, then he who was sent to teach us the Quran, he is the one who is responsible for informing us. Not Tom, or Dick, or Harry, or Ahmad. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his responsibility, it is his responsibility to inform us that this verse of the Quran is cancelled or abrogated. Did he do that? No. There is not a single hadith, not one, which supports the view that any verse of the Quran was abrogated or cancelled. I have found very few scholars to hold this view of Dr. Ansari. One of them used to be the rector of UIA some years ago. The name was Dr. Abdul Hamid Abu Suleiman, Saudi scholar. But I don't think he publicizes this view very much. The other was another Pakistani scholar who wrote a tafsir called Tadabbur al-Quran. Amir Ahsan Islahi is his name. And that tafsir has been translated into English, meticulous translation. And so now we have yet another problem of methodology. The one instance of nas everybody can read about, everyone, is the one on Al-Qarah. And when the first revelations came down, the first revelations informed us, well, in alcohol, intoxicants, there is some benefit. But the harm is greater than the death. And then came the second set of revelations which said that when you drink and you're drunk, you're not permitted to perform salah until you can understand what you're saying. And then came the third revelation which said it is now haram. And then after that came the prophetic decision to beat you, if you win. So everybody is of the opinion that the last revelation cancelled the previous ones. Okay? Alright. Okay, let's see. I got a telephone call from, what's the name of the Russian leader? Putin. So Putin said to me, I want to become a Muslim. And now that you have Sharia in force, I want to go and live in the land where there is Sharia. But I have confession to make, Imran, that I can't do away from vodka. I'm addicted to vodka. So I have a problem now. What should I tell Mr. Putin? I hope this conversation never reaches him. What should I tell Mr. Putin? He's a Russian leader. Huh? The leader of Russia wants to become a Muslim, but he calls me in the phone. Because I hold the view that there is nasq over here, and the briefest revelation of the law abrogated, I have to say to him, Mr. Putin, if you take the shahada, you become a Muslim. And once you drink, we're going to have to beat you, Mr. Putin. We're going to have to beat you. It's not going to look good.
He said, no, I don't want to be beaten.
What kind of religion you have? I want to become a Muslim. But I tell you, I'm an alcoholic. Well, Mr. Putin, we're going to have to first cure you of your alcoholism. And then you will take the shahada. So while we're curing him of his alcoholism, poor man died. Now we cannot even perform janaza over his body. We're looking like a bunch of dumb, aren't we? Because of this misapplication, this wrong theory. But suppose when Putin called me, I said to him, Mr. Primo, please repeat after me. I declare, of course in Russian, I declare there is no God but Allah. And I declare that Muhammad is the Messenger. So Putin repeating after me, on the phone. And now repeat after me, Mr. Putin, in Arabic. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He says, is that all? See, yes, you know a Muslim? You know a Muslim? MashaAllah. Could you allow me to make the announcement? CNN. So Mr. Putin then said, oh, what about my alcohol? I said, Mr. Putin, Allah is wise. Allah is wise. Allah has given us in the Quran the methodology of dealing with the situation. Mr. Putin, I have to introduce you to the first stage of the process. What's the first stage? So Mr. Putin, you're going to come to KL. When you come to KL, I have to take you to the cemetery.
Where are you taking me to the cemetery for?
I want to show you the graves of all the people who died in motor car accidents because of alcohol. Look at this one, look at that, look at the photograph. He was drinking and driving, look. So Putin is watching and watching. Becoming quite sad. Mr. Putin, we have to go to the hospital now. Why are you taking me to the hospital? I want you to show you the babies who were born because their mothers drank alcohol. I want to show you the operations which cannot take place because this man was drinking alcohol and now you cannot have surgery on him. I want to show you the damage to health. When you finish, Putin said, this is not for now, I won't be able to have dinner. All right, Mr. Putin, tomorrow I'll take you to the orphanage. Why are you taking me to the orphanage? All the divorces which have taken place because of alcohol. All the homes which have broken up because of alcohol. After all of those visits, Mr. Putin says, I really understand how when the Quran says that the harm is greater than the benefit. I think many of my countrymen will now accept Islam and give up work because it makes sense. But you see, Imran, in my case, I still can't do without you. I say, all right, Mr. Putin, never mind, you can drink. We won't beat you. But you must be regular in the masjid.
anger in the masjid. You must love the masjid. And when Mr. Putin's heart is in the masjid, and every time he comes to the masjid, everybody hugging him up and so on, then we bring it down on him. Mr. Putin, when you drink, and you run out. Out! Allah does not want you in your house. But hey, it's going to be a bad blow to him. It's a spiritual blow now, not just a physical body, the spiritual being is it. Mr. Putin is badly hit. He says, you know, I really feel the pain now that you will not allow me to pray. And most of my countrymen now will give up alcohol and police. Most. But in my case, I can't do it. Is he alright? Mr. Putin, Allah has not brought you to the third stage. The third stage is that it is prohibited for you. And if you drink, we're going to beat you. The Prophet would take the man who drank to a home, not in the masjid. And some of his companions would go with him. And they would take off their shirts and wrap it around. Or take off their sandals and beat him. So these are not acts of brutality. No. These are meant to deliver psychological blows. Make him feel embarrassed and shame. So we're going to have to do that right now. After we give Mr. Putin the first beating, he said, no alcohol. I'm not going to touch it again. I don't want another meeting. Which is better? To say to him, you cannot take the Shahada until we have cured you. Or to say to him, take the Shahada right away. The law in Islam has the wisdom to deal with this situation. But everybody, they all say that there is Nasya. And the previous revelations that have abrogated. How wrong they are. I have taken a lot of your time this morning. I've only given you a part of the subject. There's much more. But what I have shared with you this morning is enough for you to understand how important is the subject of methodology, of the study of the Quran. I want to end as I began. That only the Quran can explain the reality of the world today, can explain what is happening in the political system, international politics, in the economy, in the world of money, in the world of women. Only the Quran. And only the Quran can explain the world that's coming tomorrow. And only the Quran can guide us how we should respond to the awesome challenges that we now face. I want to end with a verse of Surah Al-Furqan, which is Surah number 25. And in it there is a complaint. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is complaining. He's complaining to Allah and he's complaining about us. Listen to the complaint. Waqala Rasul, and the Messenger of Allah said, Ya Rab, inna qawmi takhadhu hadha al-Qur'an mahjura. Surely my people have forsaken this Quran. My people have abandoned this Quran. If we do not go to the Quran, that the Quran can explain the world in which we now live, we fall in the category of people who have forsaken the Quran. I want to end with something that's going to make it difficult for you to have lunch.
I suggest you skip lunch. What is the possible punishment for those who disrespect the Quran by not studying? What is the possible punishment? I know for the banker, he's number one category for this punishment. In Surah Al-Zumar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks and says, Allah yatawaffa al-anfus hina mawtiha. Allah takes the souls of those for whom maut is ordained. وَالَّذِي لَمْ تَمُتْ فِي مَنَامِهَا. For those who do not experience maut while they are awake, Allah takes the souls when they are sleeping. فَيُمْسِكُ الَّذِي قَضَى عَلَيْهِ الْمَوْتِ. And after he takes your soul, then if maut is written for you, he keeps your soul. وَيُرْسِلُ الْأُخْرَى إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمًّى. But if maut is not written for you, he sends your soul back for a specific period of time. But during that time when he kept your soul, you were not dead. No. But they could believe you're dead. Oh yes. Because there is no medical sign of life. This is Allah's punishment. So when there was no sign of life in the morning and when you woke up, no sign of life. So they gave you the ghusl, and it is my suspicion that there are many people who are experiencing this now. This is my suspicion. Then they give you the ghusl because they think you're dead. And then they give you the clothing. And then they perform the salatul janaza. There's no sign of life. And then they bury you. But you're not dead. But they don't know that. He was not dead on the cross. But they didn't know that. They didn't know that. After they have buried you and left, then Allah returns the soul. As he did for Nabi Isa alayhi salam. So you wake up from sleep. And when you wake up from sleep, the place is pitch dark. What is this? You call out to your wife, no answer. You attempt to get up, you can't get up. Space is too small. You become confused. Where am I? Where am I? What's happened to me? And as you begin to feel in the darkness, but I didn't go to sleep with this clothing. What clothing is this? And you're feeling and feeling. And the smell of camphor. And then slowly, 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 confusion settles. And you realize you've been buried alive. And when they buried you, I wonder whether I should say this, because I don't want people to put cell phones in the grave now. They didn't know that you were alive. This is punishment. Started off by saying that Allah, who is kind and merciful and forgiving, is also terrible in his punishment. So you had no time for the Book of Allah. You never spend any time studying the Book of Allah. You send your son to Yale and to Harvard and to Stanford and to Oxford and Cambridge and the Sorbonne. You send your sons and daughters to the best Western universities. And when you can't get through there, you send them to the best local university. And when you can't get through there, you send them to some technical institute. And when you can't get through anywhere, then you send them to the Darul Uloom to become Ustad. This is the respect you have shown for the Book of Allah as an artist. The punishment. Taste the punishment. I sometimes myself sweat. Is this what's going to happen to me in the grave? We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may bless all those servants of His who after today will return to the Quran. Seriously. Using the methodology that we have begun to explain. And study the Quran with tears in your eyes and tears in your heart. Begging Allah for no word. That the Quran might explain the mysterious world in which we live today. And the even more mysterious world which is coming tomorrow. If I had another few hours, I would tell you much. The Quran might guide us how to respond to the challenges of the world today so that we may not lose faith. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا يَا مَوْلَانَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ آمين.
Yes, has been one sake, some less happy.
hear that these hadiths are recorded. Pass from one person to another from the subject of the change and then maybe incorporate into the Quran. In Malaysia, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, there was a movement regarding hadith. They say that certain hadiths are not sahih. You must try to pick up those hadiths which is not sahih in conflict with the general rules of the Quran. And try to put it aside. But this movement was being branded as an anti-hadith and became a non-starter. So how do you...
I have no comment really on your local problems. I have a duty to teach the subject.
Just the issue.
I have no comment to make on your local problems. I have a duty to teach the subject and I fulfill that duty today. Mm-hmm. It is for you now to take what I have taught here today and assess it. And if you are convinced that it is correct, only then you accept it. If you are not convinced, then you should not accept it. Once you are convinced and you have accepted it, it is now for you to find a way and means to apply it in very different societies. You have your problems there, Pakistan have their problems there, Egypt have their problems there. For example, in Malaysia, a Muslim man is not allowed to marry a Christian. That's your law. That's your law. It's in conflict with the Quran. The Quran is universally understood, universally, for 1400 years now, permitting the marriage of a Muslim man with a Christian woman and a Jewish woman. I have myself conducted a marriage with a Muslim man and a Jewish woman. So I really cannot comment. Offer solutions for your local
problem. Yes,
okay. May I differ in something? They say, there's a saying that says that this Arab awakening is a sign of the coming of the Mahdi. So what's your take on this and what shall we do? I mean, there's a saying that says we are embarking from digital or technological era to spiritual era. So this technology thing will all be wiped out. And what are we supposed to do?
I can't say that I've heard everything that you said. I heard the beginning that the Arab awakening or uprising is a sign of the coming of the Mahdi, and you want me to comment on that, is it? Yeah. There is an essay on my website. My website, imranhosein.org, in which I have given an answer to precisely this question. My answer is that it is not possible, in my opinion, for the advent of Imam al-Mahdi to occur probably for another 20 to 25 years. I would like to suggest that you may want to continue your study by reading my books. Jerusalem in the Quran was written 10 years ago. Many of you have already read that book. It's now available in Bahasa, we should be having it in a few days' time. But in addition to Jerusalem in the Quran, I also have another new book now entitled An Islamic View of Gog and Magog in the Monitor. Which is the Quran, uses the Quran to explain the world. An Islamic View of Gog and Magog in the Monitor. The surah of the Quran, which more than any other surah explains the world today, is Surah Al-Kahfi. And I have a book entitled Surah Al-Kahfi and the Modern Age. When you turn to specific problems, the one in the world of money is the one that is the most urgent. And I have a little booklet entitled The Gold Dinar and Silver Dirham. Islam and the future of money is only 50 pages. So if you read these books